Okay. Well, thanks for having me here, and welcome to my talk. It's about Docker security. I named it 201 Docker security because it's not basic, but it's a little bit more advanced. So if you're having an environment where you do Kubernetes and are very well aware of what you're doing in terms of security, this talk is not basically for you. It's going not much into depth, but I have some kind of a different approach, which you will hopefully see later. This is a slide about myself. Most people know me because I was organizing this conference, or chairing this conference, 2013 in Hamburg. That was like 5 years ago. I have participated in helping a few of the following conferences in Europe, and I did a lot for OWASP in Germany too. I'm by heart an open source guy. This is also what I like about OWASP, and the reason I got interested and eventually participated like a decade back. I have even started a project, testssl.sh, which you should check out if you haven't done so. It checks any service on any port for its TLS SSL configuration. In my paid time, I do consulting. In my early time, I was programming, but I'm not a developer at all. I did a lot of Linux and networking security way back, as basically Unix workstations were around, and you have to compile web servers and web browsers for yourself, and they carried the name NCSA. That was way before Linux was available on floppy disks. Sometime then application security were becoming very interesting. So from that Vita, you can figure I'm a very old man. So let's start with a look back in time. History is always good. For a long-time Unix user, on the first glance, I couldn't really understand why there was so much hype about Docker. Of course, I liked it, but there were other operating systems which brought containment technology also to the Unix world. First was FreeSB, which was already 18 years ago. Solaris then followed with, Solaris, rest in peace. made that a little bit more perfect, what FreeBSD did. But as Oracle took over Solaris, nobody's using Solaris anymore, so which is a pity, because their implementation of containers or zones, how they called it, were very good, in my opinion. I don't want to start technical discussion with the Docker secure or insecure, or how it compares with virtualization or bare metal system. Every technology comes with its pros and cons. This has been discussed before, so this is not my point. Just from a security standpoint, Docker containers, don't make your application less secure unless you do really stupid things. Docker was designed to be a technology which brings more security into application hosting. It has a lot of security features on board. Most of them are per default. Some need a configuration. So basically, if you're using it with putting some thoughts into it and do some security planning, you should be fine, definitely. This is, however, one of my points for security professional. It's not easy for me. So a lot of people are saying, the DevOps guys saying, very easy. But in the end, if you look at it, it's not that easy, as you figured out, because it's not really KISS. I like the KISS principle, keep it simple and stupid, because it provides less pitfalls. There's another but, which is still somehow in progress as a consequence of the technology we are using. It changed a lot, how we do things. So it depends on your maturity. That way of changing things is opening up another threats which you have to be aware of and address them properly. So from the DevOps perspective, everything could be pretty easy. appear pretty easy from a security perspective. It complicates matters and could appear not as easy as the DevOps guys are thinking. So what I'm sometimes worrying about is playing down the complexity of the security impact. I said one indicator is the word full spectrum engineer. That if you go back and Google for it, the team seems to originate from one company, which is probably well known to everybody. I'm just a modest old security guy with no reason to show off, so I'm not a friend of buzzwords, but my problem in this particular case is also that it's playing down the complexity of using a containerized environment. It's not a task, it's at all not a task which I would expect an average developer to do, to secure their own work, right? So two anecdotes maybe. If you Google for it, you find two major hits for full spectrum engineering, which is the new buzzword for DevOps guys, for DevOps security guys. One is, which is also rubbish in my opinion, is concerning lasers. Because the lasers I know have distinct wavelengths because the electrons got elevated to an excited state and they emit the radiation according to the excited state. So that's distinct and not full spectrum. The other one is also remarkable. The Americans know that probably. That's the company Northrop Grumman, which is an American weapon manufacturer and arms trading company, as Wikipedia says. They also use the word full spectrum engineer. So, okay. The rest of the talk, I will speak about threats to my containers and how to deal with them. Threats are additional points which are introduced by this. Those threats are additional points which are introduced by this technology. But the attack surface of them is not primarily exposed unless it did something utterly wrong. Exposed is only the front end microservice, which is your application. I will be talking about system and network security and information security processes on the following slides. So which is the threat to my containers? So from a security perspective, moving forward, the best is to get all threats analyzed and then probably treated as a classic approach, which is threat modeling. Okay. So the very first vector in this picture would be a security defect of the application which an attacker uses. Then I assume that there's an application escape and the attacker has landed in the container, has full control from inside the container. While the container, as the name indicates, still is supposed to contain him, there's the secondary threat that he can elevate his privileges within the container or keep on shopping in the network, right? So we can try a container escape. If successful, the attacker can get access to the host, either as a user, if the container runs on a user ID, or if a kernel uses a kernel exploit, he owns the host then and has full control over it, including all containers. The secondary threat from inside the container is accessing the network. This can be the worst case, the host, or other parts of the application which are exposed on other parts of the container, and more, of course. One thing is the orchestration tool. Today in the morning, there was a talk about Kubernetes security, which I attended. Kubernetes is, of course, one of the orchestration, or the major orchestration tool, or the most often used orchestration tool for Docker containers. And this is, of course, a very sensitive target, okay? If the attacker could reach one of the interfaces and it's not properly protected, the game is over. Okay. In the morning, as I said, we had the Kubernetes talk, so I'm going strictly through those slides. Bottom line is every orchestration tool seems to have insecure defaults, or it's easy at least to misconfigure them. CoreOS had an issue with etcd on port 2379. That is secured on Kubernetes, but the dashboard which you need to have installed is sometimes open on port 9090. There was this picture which I also had on my slides about where credentials were stolen from a Tesla AWS instance, where hackers harvested the credentials and did some mining on the AWS instances. For Kubernetes, it's more important, for example, the Kubelet API, which is supposed to be secured on a port 10,250, but it's open here, and the documentation still says by default Kubelet allows unauthenticated access to this API. So this is a threat for you. There was, before I'm finishing that part, I'd like to mention a research which was published a week ago that was from Lacework, which is worth to look at. They researched or found lots of open interfaces from orchestration networks in the internet. So they reviewed like 20,000 cloud environments, they were open, some with little access control. They also researched Kubernetes, Red Hat OpenShift, Docker Swarm. So it's pretty interesting to read that. Lacework, just Google for it if you are not aware of this research. So second vector, the host, the platform. For this one, I lack a describing picture. Another vector could be, of course, the platform you deploy your containers on. This is now looking purely from the containers perspective, right? I'm the container, and I'm looking at neighbor containers, and I'm looking at the host. So that, of course, as a container, I'm afraid that the host is insecure or that the other containers will do some harm to me. Okay, so this could be a DOS condition, for example, memory, disk, or I/O, network I/O, disk I/O. The likelihood might be a little bit smaller than for the previous mentioned threats, but the risk is likelihood by impact. Okay. By the way, this could also be a memory bug. You probably heard about those two guys. Who hasn't heard of them yet? Spectre and Meltdown. They're basically memory leaking bugs from the CPUs. It's not a perfect example, but you always have to be aware of that there might be bugs in the kernel or in the even in the CPU, which nobody assumed, that leak memory into other containers or from the host. So third vector, integrity and confidentiality of images. As I said, DevOps is also changing the way how the mini OS is deployed. Some do care what is in the mini operating system, some don't so much or do not so much. It's not only important that the microservice which you're deploying is secure, but also that the image of the operating system is you're running the microservice on. In the best case in the old world, you had a team of security engineers which provided a standardized security platform which was stripped down, hardened, and patched in time. Maybe also the attack surface was a little bit smaller because as a developer you got the platform and then you were restricted doing stuff on the operating system, which annoyed you maybe, but the ops guys took care that the operating system basis was secure. Now, in the DevOps world, the images are part of the CI/CD pipeline, and you need to make sure that they have the same level of integrity and confidentiality. So to summarize the threat management, despite what I said before, with some examples, please remember that those threats were all secondary, right? So basically, it's a good posture. However, we want to have a multi-layer defense and no higgledy-piggledy on the host or on the network behind the perimeter firewall. So, and as I said, the non-KISS principle gives you also chances to mess up things considerably. As we now identified the threats, I would like to follow up on it to provide proactive measures how to make it safe. So, the idea is to put up some Docker top 10 security. Please don't take them as risk, because the OWASP top 10 2017 or also the previous editions were risk-based. The bullet points I'm providing are more in a meant in a proactive way. I didn't find the time to make maybe an OWASP project of it, so I think there is nothing there currently, and OWASP should deserve something like that. Maybe Jack and Abdullah, are you there? No, don't see. They have tomorrow a talk, I talked to them. Maybe we can join forces, or anybody who is welcome to participate, we can put something up there. And the examples I'm showing are kept very simple. So there's no Kubernetes, no description markup language. So to get my message across, I'm only using the command line or Docker files, because it's the most common denominator. Sorry. It seems to be still common out there to write Docker files which don't specify a user under which the code runs. Okay. The user mapping is a most piece of complaint, and I think it's one thing which Docker really needs to do better. It's basically an insecure default, because everybody is using a container. If it's using the container with no proper user ID mapping, right? You won't have a hard time. You will have a hard time avoiding containers which don't run as root. If you Google for it, on the first page, you will find containers which run as root. You will also find a lot of stuff on Docker Hub, and on GitHub, it's almost the same. So basically, I would consider even this as a bug, right? Because if a technology comes up and saying, okay, we have this great thing, but in order to be more secure, you have to change the user setting, why didn't they do it? I think at a certain point one should file a bug, and this will be of course a breaking change. So for example, that this Docker Hub file which I Googled should not run anymore, but then you will have to specify a switch that relaxes the settings. This container, by the way, also cannot run on anything else as root, because it says expose 80, and unless you do something with capabilities or username spacing, the Nginx won't start. So that was kind of boring. Here's an example from a real world. Here's an except from a PS output from a bare metal system, grepping for Java processes under root. The grep command colorizes the matches. You see clearly here root. You see Java processes, which all run under root. Okay, this is not, of course, not what you want. And this scenario is giving security benefits of Docker away. Running hundreds of applications under root in containers is, from a security standpoint, almost equal to run those hundreds of applications under non-commutative privilege ID all on one host. You didn't do that in the old world, right? You didn't throw everything on one big machine. So in the new world, you shouldn't do that either. This example is maybe not the best, because Java itself also has a Java virtual machine, which has a sandbox. So exchange Java with something else, if you don't like it. Apart from another user ID, there might be cases, however, where you just cannot switch the user ID or for other reasons you want to look into user namespacing, okay? Which is an interesting concept, and it's not coming specifically from Docker. It's basically a Linux thing. This also exists for network process IDs, inter-process communication mounts, and so on and so forth. It's basically provide an isolated instance of a global resource so that the containment only sees or maps a global resource to its world, right? Docker user namespaces weren't there from the beginning. It came up in 2015. It's not particularly difficult to set up. You basically have two files where you provide the mapping, then you tell which mapping you want to have, and you need to start Dockerd with a switch. However, you should keep in mind that there are limits, as I said. It's global to Dockerd, so with every container you start, you have then a user remapping, a namespace remapping, and it's also incompatible with network or process namespacing. To bring this to an end, never run a microservice as root, use the least privilege possible. You're severely jeopardizing the major security benefit of Docker otherwise. There's no even reason to use root for any process. As I said, Docker, no, I didn't say that, but Docker does even things like port masquerading for you. If you use the expose command, probably you can map high ports into from the container into low ports like 80 or 443, right? So what I also omitted, piece of advice, a great thing is that every distribution where Docker runs on uses either UpArmor or SE Linux, right? Which also restricts in, at least from a user perspective, to escape from the container a bit. So, of course, this can be sometimes tedious. If the Docker container is something which is not expected, then it doesn't work. Please don't switch those off. UpArmor and SE Linux are there for a reason. If you switch it off, you shouldn't do this. You're just supposed to solve this. And of course, never use a privileged container, --- privileged. That has been in early times, that was the standard for the container. It allows within a container accessing all devices from the host within the container, which is bad if you think about disks, for example, or terminals. So there's the old saying that 50% of the security posture is patching in time. Surprise, surprise. Of course, this hasn't changed much in the container universe. In the container universe, you have three patch domains, I would say. The mini is in the container, of course, the host, and the orchestration tool you use. For time reasons, I cannot go into the last two, so we'll skip those, please. I can recommend that you don't skip patching on those. So coming to image patches, you need to have a strategy how to do patch management. There's a possibility either to tear down the container, do an update before your deployment, or you do it the old-fashioned way, do run an update script. This might conflict with the idea of immutable paradigm, sorry, which get later into later to. And yeah, so the best is applying patches when you start containers and restart them if there are new patches. Going back to the simple previous example, you will realize that he updated the repository information and he installed Nginx, but there's an upgrade missing there, so he didn't even install patches, which is also not best practice. In a very early time, people just had a perimeter firewall and the demilitarized zone behind it was basically flat. So that had the impact that one poorly maintained host in the demilitarized zone could screw up the whole DMZ because they would be used as a hop for attacking other hosts. You see this concept of a flat network still sometimes around in office networks where you see router management interfaces, telephones, TVs with computers and all the stuff in the same network, which is wrong. In proper network environments, this network should be separated with distinct access and authorization controls on a network layer, not on a software layer. So in a nutshell, this means translated to the container universe, you need carefully to think from a networking perspective, how do you segment your container environment properly? And on top of it, which firewalls should be applied? There are two domains. I'm talking about the internal domain first behind the firewall. So you want to avoid that a hacker who got access to a container cannot do more within your container network. And also, things get a little bit more difficult. If you have a multi-tenant environment, you should be also very careful with networking. So rule of thumb there, separate the tenants. You got to be sure that you design the network properly up front. It's difficult to change things later on. Choosing the right network drivers is the first step. For Docker alone, there are 5 network drivers, which is Bridge, Overlay, Mac VLAN, and none. Last one is, of course, the best one, because if there's some networking, there's a lot of security, but it won't work. That's a problem most of the time. For Kubernetes, there are even much more drivers. So. That's a difficult choice. There was a good slide I can recommend reading from the talk in the morning. And also, you have a lot of plugins. You can also do proper network design. So that was just behind the perimeter firewall, just internal. One thing which is often forgotten and is zero today with container security also applies for the old infrastructure, but I like the chance for a small reminder. You also need to make hackers' life more difficult by blocking at the perimeter firewall outgoing traffic, right? Not all people are doing this. So the hacker's first action, if he comes to a system, he wants to download his stuff from the internet, and you should not allow him this. It's very simple normally to block outgoing connections or to restrict outgoing connections which are allowed. So for a container, also this means if a container is small and if he doesn't have any compiler or script language on board, he has a really tough time then to get to other ports of the internal network or to do anything else on the system. One thing you also have to think about is the network security context. As opposed to the previous point, this is more meant on a system level, not on a networking level. You probably don't want to mix front-end containers with application with authorizing containers like CAS services or OAuth servers, and with backends. So, I'll give you an example: the Node Express front-end. I wouldn't put together with a MongoDB backend on one host, right? I would try to split that over a couple of hosts. So that the security context is maintained. Also, of course, I would not mix prod and dev. I would not put random code on a production network. Tenants in a multi-tenant environment, you should be careful which host you run on which service. This is probably the most difficult constellation. if you have purchased big metal machines and throw zillions of microservices on it, you can also use VMs for do another context separation, right? Because you can run Docker containers also on VMs. Keeping secrets in images might be not the best idea, but it depends on the secret and people having access to the images and the potential exposure of the image. Secrets could be credentials for writing into your database, scripting database, tokens for a backend service, like Tesla used it. I wouldn't put those images, things directly in image because it broadens, of course, your attack surface if something got stolen, see Tesla. Okay, what to do then? You have a couple of options which are mostly bad. You can use environment variables to pass it on a container, which means the container also see the context of the environment variable, which is a bad idea. You can use env files, which are just basically a pointer to environment variable, which are slightly better. Kubernetes is also very difficult. There are secrets in YAML that are different. There are different strategies how to configure it. There's a similar worse example with YAML, which is base64 encoded, which is not really better to put that in the fire. What you also can do is, for example, doing host mounts, that you do the mounts, put the secret in there, start the container, and then you move away the secrets file, so that upon starting the container, the host file the secrets file got read, but it's not there anymore for the attacker. Key value stores are a great thing, at least if I look at the specs. I haven't done any personal evaluation of that. I haven't seen that also at my customers yet. If your application is hosted at Google, AWS, or Azure, Mozilla ZOPS might be worth to look into. Resource protection. Also, if your microservices are secure, also in terms of confidentiality and integrity, there are DOS conditions on a container A and B, which might affect container C through F, right? Because they share the same host resources. So you also want to restrict CPU and memory to each of your containers to protect your host and the other containers. Basically, for memory, there are two variables. There's a catch with the first variable, because if you specify, for example, 512 megabytes here, the limiter kicks in at 1 gigabyte and not 512 megabytes. What you need to specify here is then also 512 megabytes. For CPUs, there are a number of switches which you can use. My favorite one is percent. You need probably a calculator if you have massive multi-CPU machines, but it's good to spread the load or to provide a threshold for the load for your containers. Against fork bombs, you can also do something for some services, microservices, probably very easy to specify a PID limit in a Houston container. For the attacker, it's a jackpot if he can manage to poison Docker images, as it makes it possible for him to do his evil work, or to get his evil work distributed. He's using our services, basically, and he can lean back and harvest his results. So you got to really be careful where your images come from, whom you rely on, and how your deployment pipeline is really. You probably remember a case that were some strange Docker images where Monero miners were distributed via Docker Hub. We have some images. There were like 17 images which were identified, and people pulled them, and the criminals make like 90,000 euros or so with that. So it could be anything in the Docker container. Don't want to start you to be paranoid. There is a certain level of mistrust, depending also on your company you work for banks or gambling industry where big money is at stake. You should be careful where you get the containers from. Maybe you should also audit what's in the container, like with Claire or so. What you should care about is that your CD pipeline doesn't contain any open touch points to the images. So, for example, what you shouldn't do is it's what I'm saying is really easy, but sometimes you see things different. You see, for example, sometimes servers which are in the LAN, and they you can, as an attacker, you would be able to write, if you got a container, you can write onto the servers where the images are. So this is stupid. Also, like if you have a appliance, CI/CD appliance, which has weak credentials like admin, you're all screwed, right? This is again an example where the impact is quite high and eventually will result in a bigger risk. I think I missed one slide. Ah, there it is. There's a concept of Docker Content Trust. So, which I like, but I haven't seen it in practice. I don't know, is anybody using it internally? It's basically, if you do it on the command line, like I'm doing it here, you declare a environment variable, and then you pull the container, and there's a notary server ask which is verifies the digits here, and if it doesn't have a container or is mismatched, then it says notary docker.io does not have trust data. The notary server itself is free. You can also run your own notary server for your own registry. It's open source and well documented, so it shouldn't be difficult to use them also for your provisioning. So one great thing is the great things which I like about Docker is the sound paradigm, which is often neglected, unfortunately, the immutable paradigm. So the idea behind it is that you have a piece of minimum operating system, including a software, which shouldn't be changed after deploying it, which is great from a perspective of a defense, because the hacker won't be able to download or even insert anything, any EOS stuff, right, from there. So, of course, this needs to be this would definitely put a spoke into the attacker's wheel, but reality check also says that not many people are using this feature of running a read-only container, which we really should reconsider. And sometimes, of course, if you have a database or something else, you do upload of files, you need to write, you need to allow writes. But for the containers, you don't need to allow writes. I can really recommend to make them read-only. Another measure is hardening the environment for your containers. So there are basically two things to take care of. That would be the container and the host. Also have a look at the orchestration tool, which I mentioned previously. So hardening container first is the choice of an operating system. Nowadays, I wouldn't really recommend, unless you have a container platform like CoreOS or something else, just run on a plain operating system. The choice of OS shouldn't be Ubuntu or Debian, which is a really big image. It should be stripped down image. I can recommend, for example, Alpine. I haven't looked at the other options yet. There's like Ubuntu CoreOS, but I can't. I don't have an opinion on this yet. The point is you don't need a shitload of other binaries like resize2fs, zgrep, swap on, swap off, zless or so, which is included, for example, in Ubuntu or Debian. Images. Alpine Linux is by a factor of 20 smaller, approximately, And if you need more, you can just add it. If there are SUID binaries on your container operating system of source, you can just wipe them out. If you start the container with a security opt equals no new privileges. It's a very cool thing. Linux capabilities is also a very cool thing. It's worth to look into. CAPS stands, well, as said, Linux capabilities are basically a group of system calls into the kernel. System calls are those calls which are used by kernel exploits, if they are available. Under Linux, there are currently 40 Linux capabilities, which is basically a group of each syscalls. By default, Docker already reduces this significantly. If you see here in the picture, this was an OpenVAS server, or OpenVAS Docker container, which contained a Redis server, and if you count, should be 14 capabilities which are left over. So that's significantly reduced. But for example, I don't think you will need here a NetRAW, something like that, mconnot. I also would say you won't need that. So you basically, there's no reason. You can also work on that and switch it off. That limits the impact of kernel exploits. If you want it more fine-tuned, you can use SecComp, which just stands for secure computing, which is probably not known to everybody, which is basically this is SecComps are basically, with SecComps you can control every Linux syscall. They're like 300, 340, depending on the architecture you're working on. You can provide a profile in JSON format and can switch it on and switch it off, whatever you want. Google Chrome makes use of it, and some other applications to prevent stuff which is evil. Very important, of course, is the host. Besides patching, there are two things to take care of. First is don't run any services on the host, which isn't necessary. You should restrict yourself to SSH and NTP. And maybe some other stuff which is needed. Shut every other service down, or restrict access on those services on the network layer at least. Then, secondly, don't take a standard or a Debian distro with a workload of non-needed libraries and binaries. Use a minimum operating system for this. You don't need a compiler or desktop system for environment there. This is your barebone system. This needs to be hardened, right? Apply some hardening. You also want to have a look at special container operating systems. Or when you can cope with it, I recommend CentOS or Red Hat Enterprise Linux because it provides some advantages to SE Linux. Showstopper for kernel exploits would be either patching in time, or if you cannot, using PUX and GR security, because basically, bless you, which are basically harden the kernel so that it's more immune against kernel exploits. That patches didn't make it into the mainline kernel yet, but in real life, I'm afraid that it won't run anyway. I've followed that a bit, and it will interfere with operations. So unless you have a really cool Linux hacker there who can solve the problems, I cannot recommend it. Logging, of course, this is my last point. It's, by coincidence, it's just the same of Overstop 10 2017. Of course, I would like to know what's happening in my container with my orchestration tool, the application, with every system server in the container. Docker has a number of default drivers for this, like JSON file is a default driver. It has gale format, it has syslog. Use them in Pipes in the proper remote logging system, which is safe. In the main page of Docker run, there's also EVA host mount. You shouldn't mount the log device. If you do that, you would automatically get the logs on the host. I can recommend doing this because you don't share log devices, or just don't share devices down to the container from a host perspective. Also, if you want to look, if you're eager, whether you properly have kernel exploits, or if you're running a Zeem, you have to switch on Linux auditing anyway. So that way, you would get Linux syscalls also on the host, which is a great thing. Do it yourself. There are sys benchmarks. Sys just stands for Center of Information Internet Security. You can get the Kubernetes and Docker benchmark through the website, but you have to leave an email address there. But you can also go to GitHub. There are like 100 something checks which they do. And to order understand what they are doing, you need to get the PDF anyway, so probably you need to leave your email address. So this is a simple example from my laptop. You see here, UpArmor is enabled. I don't have Security Enhanced Linux enabled. I don't have privileged containers, and so on and so forth. This gives you a clue. Also, it's colorized what is restricted and what could be done better. So that looks quite different, of course, in production. This is a snapshot from a Kubernetes systems. Here you have 0.41, ensure user for the container which has been created. This was basically the Docker benchmark, which I run on the system you have seen before. We see Java processes. This looks like this then. So the output is getting a little bit bigger then. So I hope I could give you some insights what to do and what rather not, but also matter how to do it. You need to design a plan before implementing and also follow the plan. Otherwise, I found this picture quite neat. Otherwise, security guys have to do the following. If you happen to come into this environment, that might be a sign that they have underestimated the complexity. Okay. Good. That was it. Thank you.